I always thought Eric was a perfect subject, but the documentary was actually something he asked me about. And I knew he had an interesting life, but I didn't want to make assumptions the way, you know, some people do on these things and then you back into. I wanted to have it be a journey where I discovered things about Eric that I didn't know. And that made it very challenging. But I don't think that if Eric hadn't asked me, I would have never asked him to do something like this. I was somewhat concerned that there may be an impression, because we've been friends for so long, that I would whitewash something, or Eric would say, take it out, and none of that happened. Because of the trust that we have, and of the fact that he gave me this responsibility and didn't second guess me. The thing that he did do is that he came up with the idea of Gustavo Santaella, which the score is such an incredible blend, because we didn't want it to be all just Eric's music, because it doesn't work that way. And you can't all of a sudden introduce something orchestral, because it wouldn't blend with Eric's stuff. So it was Eric's idea, and you were even so gracious about that. You said, do you mind if I suggest? So Gustavo has done an incredible job. He was very excited to do it. He's been very generous, and I'm very grateful to you for that idea. This was my first documentary. Without Chris King, my editor, the beginning of this process was daunting with Chris King. First of all, as I was saying last night, this wasn't a period of time where people like whipped out a phone and said, oh, here, let me have my picture taken with you. So there isn't a lot of stuff. The YouTube thing, what I'm actually referencing is that there is something that you can potentially clear someday, but right now what you have is a crappy version of somebody in the audience or something. I don't know how people did this before the internet. I mean, if a researcher, an archivist, had to go to all the places where this material came from, we'd be making the movie for another 4 years. Well, some things, you know, at the beginning, when Eric and I talked about it, you know, he says, I don't have any pictures. You know, as I said last night, he's not somebody who scrapbooks. So he really didn't have a lot of pictures to his knowledge. Fortunately, because he's lived at Hurtwood for so long, there are some boxes in the attic. But he also had footage that he probably hadn't given thought to in a shed in Devon or something. So there, you know, it becomes a lot of detective work. And then you're kind of dependent upon, oh, I kind of remember somebody said there was a, you know. So it's that process. And this period, as I said, is very difficult because he didn't stand next to his friends and say, take a bunch of pictures of me. And so some of the places that we got the footage were surprising. The home footage, which I didn't, with your mother, etc. I don't think you had seen that, I don't know. You know, that came from a family member who happened to have kept it from his mother's estate. So we were lucky. The Duane Allman radio interview. When we first started, there was nothing of Duane Allman ever talking about doing Derek and the Dominoes. Things like that, those are real treasures. One of the things that was so interesting to me when I was doing the movie was that Uncle Mac had this show where he was playing blues music that Eric and other musicians of his generation were really exposed to. And there are other musicians that had the exact effect, and they may not have been as talented as Eric, but it took them to this place to have an interest in the guitar. And I think that is a big part of what instrument somebody chooses. He heard this guitar, Eric. He heard this guitar as a 9-year-old boy. He heard this music, and he was touched by it. And he didn't have anything to make it easy. He had an acoustic guitar that he did his best with. And then, this isn't in the movie, but he had an electric guitar with no amp. And he was playing on the strings with no amp, but he said he knew what it would sound like. That is real determination. That is making something work. And I think that that's what happens. If guitar sales are down, maybe nobody's hearing something that moves them. And I also think, in another way, rock and roll and in its origins in blues isn't the popular music of this moment. So, I don't know why. I'd love to do a whole thing on why this post-war generation in the UK was so drawn to the blues and interpreted it so well. But I haven't had time to do that one yet.